Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My dear students, you are still welcome to another episode of our online classes. As you know that our last class, we treated the last part of our first topic, which was mechanical energy, where we discussed machine and types of machine, how we can solve or calculate simple problems as regards a machine. And like I told you that the first assignment has been forwarded together with your notes. So we'll be expecting the second part of the assignment for our first topic, that is under mechanical energy. And let me still reiterate this, please. The first assignment that I gave you people, it was, I think, only 4 students among you forwarded the feedback, the solution. So I'm still expecting others, some of you, to forward yours. And in case, because I learned that most of you are having a problem or challenges in accessing the portal by surfing through the portal and submitting you submit your assignment, you can use my WhatsApp number, which is 070-65-933-261. Just solve the question, you snap it, then you forward it to my WhatsApp page. So I think that one will still help. So my number again is 070-65-933-261. This is my WhatsApp number. So you solve your assignment. If you think that using the Islamic College portal to submit your assignment will give you a headache or problem, so use this other channel, my WhatsApp page. Now, today we are looking at the second topic. Don't forget, I'm giving you people a scheme of work for this time, total. So out of those scheme of works, the first one was mechanical energy. So the second one is a measurement of heat energy. If you are following the scheme very well. So under measurement of heat energy, so the first thing we are going to look at are heat and what? And temperature. We are going to look at heat and temperature. In this particular area of this topic, we try to give the meaning of heat, give the meaning of temperature, the similarities or differences that exists between heat and temperature. So what differentiates between heat and temperature? Because most people normally confuse the meaning of heat and temperature. So we look at what differentiates heat and temperature. So we also look at some other things as regards heat and temperature in this topic. So let's quickly begin. So what is heat? Or I can say heat or heat energy. Don't forget, we have different forms of energy. We have the mechanical energy, that even we talk of the energy used by body to perform work, be it potential or kinetic energy. We have chemical energy. We have light energy. We have heat energy. We have electrical energy. We have solar energy. So there are many. Don't forget that each of these energy can be converted. Nobody can create each of these energy, but we can convert them from their original form to another form. For instance, we might have electricity. From electricity, we have what we call electrical energy. This electrical energy can be converted to any other form of energy. It can be converted to light energy. How will the electrical energy be converted to light energy? Using a device known as bulb, B-U-L-B. Some people call it glow, so it's bulb. Now, using bulb, if you switch on, you connect your bulb to electrical means, and then you switch it on, what's going to happen? The electrical energy stored in the electricity will be converted to what? To light energy through the use of what? Bulb. It's that the electrical energy can also be converted to what? To heat energy. How do you think, or how do we convert electrical energy to heat energy? So we can do that using some thermal devices, like iron, like hot plate, like some of these materials, I think you are familiar with them, like boiling ring. For instance, if you connect your boiling ring to electrical means, the energy starts flowing through the boiling ring. What happened at the other end of burning ring? So that metal called burning ring starts heating up, becomes hot. So it means that that's, and if you dip that burning ring into maybe a pot of water, within some minutes, what happened to the water? The water becomes a boil. In that, the electrical energy has been converted to what? To heat energy. So we have various ways that an energy can be converted from one form to another. Now, let's quickly look at it. What is heat energy? Heat energy is defined, is a form of energy. We call it thermal energy. Heat energy can also be called thermal energy. Heat energy. Or, we call it what? Thermal. Thermal means heat. Thermal means heat. So, heat energy or thermal energy. So, is so the heat energy or thermal energy is the energy possessed by a body, or is the energy that flows from a region of high temperature to a region of low temperature. That is one. We can also redefine heat energy or thermal energy as the energy that has been transferred from a hot object to a cold object. As a result, please mind this last sentence. As a result of their difference in what? In temperature. I repeat, heat or thermal energy is a form of energy that is transferred from a hot object to a cold object as a result of what? Difference in temperature. Now, we can also redefine heat or thermal energy as a measure of total internal energy of a body. Measure of what? Total internal energy of a body. Now, go back to the first definition, that is the transfer of energy from a hot to a cold. The energy, one thing you need to know is that the heat energy always flows. But it flows in what direction? It flows in the direction that is from a warm or hot object to a cold object. It cannot flow from cold object to hot object. Please take note of that. It flows from hot object to cold object. And we can also indicate, or we can easily determine or see the flow or the direction in which this heat is being flowed from that hot to cold object. As a result of what? As a result of the temperature difference between that hot object and cold object. For instance, if the two bodies are at the same temperature point, that is, if we have point A, let's say I have object A is at 50 degrees Celsius of temperature, and I have body B is also at what? Let's say 20 degrees, or let's say 5 degrees Celsius. You can see that which body is at, now before I go into this, let me quickly explain temperature, so that because the two are somehow interwoven. So temperature is the degree, as we all know, is the degree of hotness or coldness of a body. The degree of hotness or coldness of the body. Or is the a measure of total kinetic energy of what? Of the body. Or is a measure of average kinetic energy of the body. That is, the temperature is a measure of how the heat energy flows from one object to another. The temperature is not the heat itself, but is a measure of how that heat energy flows from one hot object to what? To a cold object. Now let's look at this. We have two bodies, A and B. The body A is at 50 degrees Celsius, and the temperature of body A is 50 degrees Celsius, and the temperature of body B is what? 5 degrees Celsius. Now the heat energy is made because A is at higher heat energy. B is at lower heat energy, that is at a small temperature. So the heat is going to flow from body A or system A to body B or system B. It cannot flow from body B to body A. So it will only flow from a region of higher temperature to a region of lower temperature. And what's the reason of that? Because there is a temperature difference. You can see that this body here, body B or system 1, system B, they don't have the same temperature value. For instance, let's assume I have body A having a 50 degrees Celsius, and also body B is having 50 degrees Celsius. Here, with the heat flows, that's a question. With the heat flows, and the two systems are at the same value of temperature, 50 degrees Celsius, 50 degrees Celsius. In this case, the heat cannot flow because the two of them, there's no temperature difference here. In fact, temperature difference means different in the value of the temperature of two bodies. That is, different in this value of the temperature of these two bodies be 50 minus 50, and the temperature change will be the same. In that case, the heat energy will not flow. In this case, whenever we have a system of this nature, we say body A and body B are in thermal equilibrium. They are in what? Thermal equilibrium. Thermal equilibrium. Thermal means heat. We can say heat or thermal equilibrium. That is, in this thermal heat equilibrium, no heat will flow in both directions because they are the same level of temperature or heat. So the heat will only flow when there is temperature between the two bodies. In which the heat will now flow from a higher temperature body to a lower temperature body. So that's the definition for heat and temperature. Now, can we measure heat and temperature? Can we measure heat and temperature? Now, how do we measure heat and temperature? Let me say this. Heat energy cannot be measured. It's not possible for us to measure it. There's no that instrument, no instrument that we can use to measure heat energy. Now, but the temperature can be measured. We use a device called thermometer to measure temperature of a body. But there's no specific instrument that we can use to measure the heat energy of the body. The only thing we can do to measure the heat energy of the body is by way of calculation. So we can only calculate for heat. We can only calculate for heat of the body. So there's no measuring instrument to determine or to detect the amount of heat energy residing in a particular system or in a particular body. But temperature can be measured using a device called thermometer. And the unit of energy, I'm going to send the note to you. So you have all this in your notes. And this video is very, very important because there are some of the explanation that will not reflect in your note. So I want you to pay attention in this to this explanation. Now, the heat energy, because it's a form of energy, so its unit, the unit of heat energy is joules. The unit of energy is what? It is joules. Unit of heat energy is joules. That's the unit for work or energy. Why the unit for temperature? The unit of temperature is, we have three units to express. We have three that we normally use to express our temperature. We can use what you call degree Celsius. You can use what you call degree Fahrenheit. And as I said, you can use another unit called Kelvin. You can use a unit called degree Celsius, and then you can express our temperature in terms of degree Celsius, or in terms of degree Fahrenheit, or in terms of what? Kelvin. But the most standard acceptable unit among these three is Kelvin. So that is, the SI unit of temperature is Kelvin. SI unit of temperature is what? Is Kelvin. So you take note of that. And so we have differences between heat and temperature. We have differences between heat and temperature. One of the differences, I've already mentioned them in terms of the definition, that is, heat energy is a measure of total internal energy of the body. Total internal energy of the body. While temperature is a measure of the average kinetic energy of it, that is the rate or the way in which energy is being flowed. Heat energy is flowed from one body to another. That's temperature. So another difference that I see between the two, I mean heat and temperature, is that heat energy cannot be measured with a device, with a measuring device, but temperature can be measured using thermometer. Another difference is that heat energy is measured in joules, while temperature is measured in the degree center of the degree Fahrenheit or Kelvin, and then the rest. And I've already told you that heat energy cannot be measured, while temperature, heat energy can be calculated for, cannot be measured, and temperature can become. Now, what are the sources of heat? What are the sources of heat? Where do we see or can we observe heat energy or thermal energy? We have different ways in which we can observe heat energy. The most closest one to every one of us that we normally experience in our day-to-day activities or life is the solar radiation. You know that the solar radiation, from that solar radiation, whether you go out in the during the day, what do you observe, what do you feel as a result of that solar radiation? You feel it. You mean that the heat energy is transferred from the source, from the particular source coming from the sun to here, to the air surface, to our body, through the process called radiation. So the solar radiation is one of the perfect form of heat energy. Another form of heat energy that I can still give is that, you know, your stove, if you light up your stove, it brings out a flame. If you touch that flame, what happens? It feels somehow, it's going to feel somehow hot. So it means that you've experienced what you call heat energy. Another thing is that you place a pot of water on a stove or using your hot plate for some minutes. What happens to that pot of water? You use your bare hand to place it on the hot plate. But after 30 minutes, when the water is boiling, can you still use your bare hand again to remove the pot of it? See that one is not boiling. Why? Because that pot will have become hot, or would have become heated as a result of the heat being transferred from the hot plate to that pot. So also, you have to prepare your hot coffee or hot tea early in the morning. You see that you cannot easily sip it. Why? Because that tea or the coffee is hot. It's somehow hot. That's because that hot tea, they have what you call the heat energy in it. So we have different sources of heat energy. Now, so let's quickly go to what we called thermometric substance. And before we talk about thermometric substance, so we want to dwell more on temperature here. We want to dwell more on what? Temperature. So let's look at this. So we've already discussed that temperature is the degree of all the coldness of the body. The degree of hotness or coldness of what? Of the body. We have what we call thermometric substance for any typical thermometer. Thermometric what? Substance. What is thermometric substance? The thermometric substance is the liquid, the substance or liquid used. It may not be liquid, but any substance or material used to measure the temperature of a body. I'm going to show you a typical, or give you an example of a typical thermometric substance. I think you are familiar. Okay, if you are not familiar with laboratory because you are an LS2, you might not be able to see the laboratory thermometer before. So let me show you a perfect example of laboratory thermometer. I think you can see it. This is an example of laboratory thermometer. So it has a range of values from 10 to 100 degree. It has a range of temperature between minus 10 to 110 degree. Between minus 10 and 110 degree. Some might have between 0 and 100 degree Celsius. Some might have 0 and 100 degree Celsius. Now, if you check, this is what we call laboratory thermometer, the one we use in the lab to measure the temperature of any body. Now, inside it, we have the liquid. That liquid, we call it, that liquid can either be mercury or alcohol. That's why we call this type of laboratory thermometer, we call it liquid in glass. It's made of glass. The thermometer substance, that is the substance inside it, is liquid in form of mercury or alcohol. Now, these thermometer substances now change. It's the one that is going to be changing with the temperature that we want to measure. For instance, I want to use this thermometer to measure the temperature of water that is boiling. I will dip the base of this. I think you can see it. This base is sulfide colored. So this, I will dip it inside that hot water. You will see that liquid, mercury inside it, rising in respect to the amount of the temperature of that heated water. So, because the temperature is increasing, so that volume of the mercury will also be changing with temperature. So that mercury that is changing inside this glass block, we call it the thermometric substance of this thermometer. We call it thermometric substance of this thermometer. So we also have another example of or another types of thermometer. So here in your note, you see a particular table where we discuss thermometer, that is type of thermometer, the thermometric substances, and the properties of the thermometric substance. For instance, under types of thermometer, you will see liquid in glass thermometer. I told you an example of liquid in glass thermometer is this laboratory thermometer. Why is it liquid in glass? The whole thermometer is made of glass, as you can see. Liquid in, that is, we have liquid that is going to be changing with temperature I want to measure. So the liquid inside is mercury. So we call it mercury in glass, a form of liquid in glass thermometer. We can also have another version which is alcohol-based thermometer. That's it. The liquid inside it will not be alcohol. Now, what is going to be the type of thermometer is liquid in glass thermometer. Now, what's going to be the thermometric solvent? The thermometric solvent, that is the solvent that is going to be changing with the temperature, is the mercury inside this glass tube. Now, the thermometric properties, the property of this thermometric solvent is that the volume of this mercury will be changing or will be increasing with increasing in the temperature. Or the volume of the mercury will be decreasing with decrease in what? In the temperature. For instance, I want to measure I place a pot of hot water on the stove. Then I want to use this thermometer to measure the temperature of that hot water. You can see that the temperature will be increasing. Then the volume of this mercury will be increasing depending on the amount of the temperature of that water at that particular point in time. It might be 40, it might be 50, it might be 60, it might be 70, it might be 100. If it is 100, it means that water has boiled. And don't forget the boiling point of a pure water is what? Is 100 degrees Celsius. While the freezing or the melting point of pure water is what? Is 0 degrees Celsius. But when you now dip this one inside the cold water, that is the water that you've already put inside the fridge or freezer, just bring it down and then you place this thing inside. You see that instead of the temperature to be increasing, then the temperature level is going to be decreasing. Maybe to measure below, if the temperature of that water is 2 or 5 or 10 degrees, that volume of mercury will be decreasing. If that water has all that substances as feces below 0 degrees Celsius, if it's temperature can measure below the 0 degrees Celsius, so the value of that or the volume of that mercury is going to be decreasing. We decrease in value of what? In value of the thermometer that we are measuring. So don't forget, we said we have the thermometric substance. The thermometric substance is a substance or material that we use in a thermometer, in which its property changes with the temperature that we are measuring. Now, we have two types of scales for any typical thermometers. So we have two types of scales or two types of points on a thermometer. What are the types of points on a thermometer? So the first one, we have upper fixed point and two lower fixed points. we have the upper fixed point, and then we have the lower fixed point. What is the upper fixed point of a thermometer? Upper fixed point of a thermometer is the temperature scale on a thermometer. The upper fixed point of a thermometer is the temperature scale, is the temperature scale on a thermometer, which indicates the boiling point of pure water, which indicates the boiling point of pure water at normal atmospheric, at normal standard atmospheric pressure. What is that normal standard atmospheric pressure? Is 760 millimeter mercury. I repeat, the upper fixed point of the thermometer is the temperature scale. Is the temperature scale which indicates that the temperature scale on a thermometer, on a table thermometer, which indicates the point of which indicate the boiling point of pure water at normal standard atmospheric pressure. Why the lower fixed point of the thermometer is that temperature scale on the thermometer, which indicates the melting point of, which indicate the melting point or freezing point of normal ice at standard atmospheric pressure, which is 760 millimeter mercury. Now, let us assume we have the Celsius scale of the thermometer. Celsius scale of the thermometer. For instance, Celsius. Okay, under this, we are still going to look at types of scales. So let's quickly look at the types of scales. Type of scales for thermometer, for temperature. Type of scale. I told you that our temperature can be specified in terms of degree Celsius, degree Fahrenheit, and Kelvin. So let's really look at these types of scales. I'm having this theory. So here, for degree Celsius scale, this is degree Celsius. Degree Celsius scale. You have degree Fahrenheit scale. Then you have the Kelvin scale. Kelvin scale. I have degree Celsius, degree Fahrenheit scale. Then I have the Kelvin scale. Kelvin scale. Please, in your note, you will see some areas where I put space for diagram. If I'm drawing the diagram here, please, make sure when you are using my own note to prepare your own note, where you see space for diagram, you make sure you draw those diagrams. If the diagram, I didn't draw a diagram when explaining, so you can consult any of your textbooks to look for the diagram, or any other textbook that you might have, so to look for the diagram there. Now, let's look at these three types of scales. Now, the Celsius, we have the Celsius or centigrade scales. You can call it Celsius or centigrade scale. This is Fahrenheit scale. Why this one is Kelvin scale? Please, your degree Celsius is written in this manner. C naught, degree naught. We have degree Fahrenheit, but your Kelvin has no any degree. Please repeat me. Now, for Celsius scale, the upper fixed point is 100 degrees Celsius. Why the lower fixed point is 0 degrees Celsius? They call this one theta. The upper fixed point for degree Fahrenheit, this one is 100 degrees Celsius. The upper fixed for degree Fahrenheit is 212 degrees Fahrenheit. The lower fixed point for degree Fahrenheit is 32 degrees Fahrenheit. Then at the mid point, I have F. Now for Kelvin scale, for Kelvin scale, the upper fixed point is 373 Kelvin, while the lower fixed point is 273 Kelvin. So at the mid point here, I have K, representing the temperature value between the lower fixed point and the upper fixed point. This degree Fahrenheit represents the value of the temperature between the lower fixed point of degree Fahrenheit and the upper fixed point. Likewise for the degree Celsius scale. Now we have what you call fundamental interval of temperature. What is that fundamental interval? The fundamental interval is just the difference between the difference in values between the upper fixed point of the thermometer and its lower fixed point. I repeat, the fundamental interval of a typical thermometer is the difference in value between the upper big square of that America and its lower big square. For instance, what is the fundamental interval of this degree Celsius? The answer is going to be 100 minus 0. That is 100 degree. That is 100. What is the fundamental interval of degree Fahrenheit? That is 212 minus 32. That fundamental interval for degree Fahrenheit will be what? 180. Not 180 degree, but 180. What is the fundamental interval for Kelvin scale? That is 373 minus 273. This one is going to also give us what? 100. 100. So the fundamental interval. So I can say that. Please look here. Look here. I want to measure from here to here. From here to here is 100. That is fundamental interval for this. From here to here is 180. The fundamental interval for this. This one is 180. And from here to here is 100. So the fundamental interval for this is also 100. Please take note. Please take note. So the fundamental interval is 100. So let's look at how we can convert. How we can convert from one scale to another. How we can convert from one scale to another. Conversion from one scale to another. So conversion from one scale to another. So the first one. Degree Celsius to Kelvin. Let's see how we can convert an expression that we can use to convert from degree Celsius to Kelvin. What we are going to use here is this. Please look. I want you to pay that attention. Now, what we're going to do is that we find difference between this point, theta, change in value between theta and 0 degrees. So I will have theta minus 0 over the upper fixed point minus the lower fixed point, 100 minus 0. Equal, we repeat the same thing for Kelvin because I want to find the expression to convert from say degree Celsius to Kelvin. So I'm comparing degree Celsius to Kelvin, degree Celsius scale to Kelvin scale now. So you can see the midpoint here is K. That is, what I did for this one is theta, the midpoint, minus the lower fixed point. Then I will use the same thing. I will repeat the same thing. That is K minus the lower fixed point. I have K minus 273 over upper fixed point minus the lower fixed point. That is 373 minus what? 273. If you perform, you solve for this, you are going to have theta in degree Celsius over 100 equal K minus 273 over what? 373 minus 273 give what? 100. So from here, this 100, we can do this 100. Which means that if I want to convert from degree Celsius to Kelvin, what I just need to do is to subtract 273 from the value of Kelvin we are given. Don't worry, we are going to solve an example so that you also understand it better. So from here, I can also make my K the solid formula. So my K will be theta in degree Celsius plus what? 273. This is how you can convert from Kelvin to degree Celsius or from degree Celsius to Kelvin. So let's look at the conversion from degree Celsius to degree Fahrenheit. So we repeat the same thing. We do the same thing the same way we did for the first one. We do the same thing. That means we are comparing degree Celsius scale and degree Fahrenheit scale. What are we going to do there? Theta, the midpoint here, we have theta minus 0 over upper visual minus lower visual, that is 100 minus 0. If we repeat the same thing for the degree Celsius scale, that is the midpoint is degree Fahrenheit minus the lower this point. I have degree Fahrenheit minus, that is F, minus what? The lower fixed point, which is what? 32. Everything over the upper fixed point, which is 212. 21 minus the lower fixed point, which is what? Which is 32. If we solve this, now we simplify this, we are going to have theta over 100 equal F minus 32 everything about 2 times 32, we give what? We give 180. Don't forget that this 100 you obtain here is the fundamental interval for the business. This 180 you obtain here is the fundamental interval for what? For the green finite. That is the difference between the upper and then the lower fixed point. So from here now, I can make my theta in degrees Celsius. My theta in degrees Celsius, I can make it the solver formula. Or if I like, I can make my f the solver formula. Making theta in degrees Celsius the solver formula, then we have making theta in degrees Celsius the solver formula. From that expression, I have theta degrees Celsius equal 100 by cross multiply divided by 180 multiplied by f minus 32. Now simplify that one further, we have 5/9 into bracket f minus 32. This is how we can convert from degree Fahrenheit to degree Celsius, as the case may be. So from here now, I can also make my f the solver formula. From here, I can make my f the solver. If I make my f the solver formula, and we have degree Fahrenheit equal 9/5 plus 32. So we take note of these. Convert. So that's how you can convert from degree Celsius to Fahrenheit, or from degree Fahrenheit to what, to Celsius, or from Kelvin to degree Celsius, or degree Celsius to what, to Kelvin. So let's really look at one or two examples under that. Let's look at example under that. So the first example you have in your notes, the note that's going to that I'm going to send together with this video, is that you have example one. Example one says that convert 30 degrees Celsius to Roman figure one to degree Fahrenheit Roman figure two to Kelvin. Convert 30 degrees Celsius to degree Fahrenheit. And to get very simple, say you know what the expression that we can use to convert from degree Celsius to Fahrenheit, from degree Fahrenheit to what, to Celsius. Now, solution. You say solution. For first one, what we are given is what? We are given theta in degrees Celsius to be what? 30 degrees Celsius. Then we are looking for what? F. We are looking for all F or no. So which one are we going to use? We are going to use this second expression. Because we are given C, we are looking for what, degree Fahrenheit. Then therefore, you see degree Fahrenheit equal 9/5C plus what, 32. If you substitute this value, you discover that you have 9/5 multiplied by C is what, the C is Celsius scale that we are given is 30, multiplied by 30, then plus 32. Please and please, you cannot just solve this using ordinary algebra expression, but rather you use your knowledge of Bodmer. You first multiply 9 times 30 divided by 5 before you add it to what? 32. If you do that, our final answer for this will not be what? If you do that, our final answer will be 86 degree Fahrenheit. So let's begin to solve for the second one. That is how we can convert 30 degrees Celsius to Kelvin. So let's quickly solve for that. Now, we have to go to Kelvin. And then my theta in degrees Celsius equal what? 30 degrees Celsius. So which expression are we going to use? We just use that our K, because I'm looking for Kelvin, equal theta degrees Celsius plus what? 273. Just add 273 to that. Now, our K from here will be 30 plus what? 273. Adding 30 and 273, we obtain 303 Kelvin. Don't forget that the SI, the standard unit for temperature, for experimental temperature, is what? Is Kelvin. So you take